Hey guys, there's a random video I found here that I want to address and respond to. And I know it's been a while since we took a look at creationists, but that's what makes it all the more exciting. Okay, so this guy here is trying to debunk antibiotic resistance as a form of evolution. As you know, it's one of the most classic examples of survival of the fittest. But yeah, there's something quite similar happening right now to the virus that is currently causing today's pandemic. Interestingly enough, I have responded to this channel before, and they occasionally have these videos that are produced with very high quality, and by quality I mean that they make very good animations. Definitely better than the lazy frame-by-frame images I use for myself. But yeah, that doesn't give them any credit for the arguments in the video though, and that's what we're primarily focused on. Okay, roll the clip.
Hey doc, I think I've got an ear infection. Antibiotics are a wonderful medicine when dealing with bacterial infections, but unfortunately they're sometimes misused. When antibiotics are misused, it can lead to them suddenly not working anymore. And if you ask folks like Richard Dawkins and Bill Nye the Science Guy, the answer is that this is incontrovertible proof of evolution right before our very eyes. It's an evolutionary arms race, they say. As our weapons of medical warfare get stronger and more sophisticated, so too, the bugs we're fighting are getting stronger. They're evolving better defenses, making them immune to the best we can throw at them.
Personally, I would never call it an evolutionary arms race, because when I hear that, I hear of something like coevolution, or two competitors evolving to fight one another. The most common examples of this is a predator-prey relationship. Plants that get eaten evolve in different ways, such as creating denser seed shells or pine cones to prevent them from being eaten by squirrels. Then the squirrels evolve to have stronger front teeth to more easily break the seeds they want to eat. This coevolution will change both parties in a direction because of their constant pressure to outperform the other. So yeah, when I hear the term evolutionary arms race, that's what I think of. I don't think it is very accurate in describing the situation of bacteria via antibiotics though, because one is evolving and the other is just man-made. Oh well. Also, it's inaccurate to say our antibiotics are getting stronger. More like they change so that there are new methods of killing bacteria that the bacteria have not evolved against. You know, fun fact, we actually are losing this war. Bacteria are becoming resistant faster than we can develop new antibiotics. It's kind of scary to think that we'll eventually come to the point in which these superbugs are incredibly difficult to defeat. Honestly, more people need to be concerned about this. There are many countries that simply do not care about this problem. For example, I made a video last year about China and them giving out antibiotics like it's candy. This is a serious issue that we need to talk about more.
Bacterial evolution and antibiotic resistance is one of the all-time greatest hits regarding evidence for evolution.
Evolution is happening all around us at all times. Antibiotic resistance is just a common example used because people understand it and it's easy to see the consequences of it, and therefore easy to portray as an argument.
There's a lot of ways for antibiotics to defeat bacteria. Some explode it. Some gum up the works. Some starve the little bugs out. Others prevent them from multiplying, and so on.
I love it. That was pretty good.
But there's essentially only one or two ways that bacteria can become resistant to antibiotics. The first and most common way bacteria gain resistance is that it's always been there. Antibiotic-resistant bacteria actually pre-exist the invention of modern antibiotics.
What? I thought you were going to list the actual methods of antibiotic resistance as classified by biologists. Preventing or limiting drug intake, breaking down the drug, ejecting the drug out, or changing the drug target. These are actual ways in which a bacteria becomes resistant. But instead, it seems you're trying to classify it on a bigger scale, claiming that these antibiotic resistant genes already exist. Alright, I'm a little disappointed, but please continue.
There's an interesting story of some Arctic explorers from back in the 1800s. Turns out they froze to death before the discovery and use of antibiotics. Some morbid scientists found them recently and took samples of their gut bacteria and found that they already had resistance to some of our most powerful modern antibiotics.
Okay, so let's break this down further. They don't really go into much detail regarding the article they cite, so you know what we're gonna do. We're gonna read the article they referenced. She said two of the six strains of bacteria, all of which belong to the Clostridium genus, or group of species, were found to be partly resistant to the antibiotic cefoxitin, which was introduced in 1978, and clindamycin, introduced in 1970. Resistance to antibiotics may be induced by the body's reaction to heavy metals, this researcher, whom I cannot pronounce the name, said, speculating that environmental pollution may be contributing to the development of resistance to antibiotics by bacteria. It's totally speculative, said microbiologist Joseph Cornfield, a spokesman for the American Society of Microbiology, but added the hypothesis could be tested by growing modern-day bacteria with increasing concentrations of lead and determining if they start to resist antibiotics. Yes, indeed, this could be easily tested in a laboratory to see if metals could indeed lead to antibiotic resistance. Personally, I don't know how the mechanism would work, but regardless, there's always going to be some members of the population that will be resistant to pretty much any drug. If you think about it, that's how evolution has to work. at least some of the members of the population, have to be resistant already, whether that came about through mutation or any other method. But of course, it usually isn't significant enough to grow a culture around. My hypothesis is that something made it resistant already, perhaps a similar substance to cefoxitin in clindamycin, that had antibiotic properties already existed. There's simply no real way to know for sure unless we conduct some experiments. I wouldn't jump to the conclusion right away that these antibiotic-resistant genes already existed as a major component of the bacterial population, because as the creationist will mention later, if there isn't any advantage to the resistance, it's eventually removed via evolution. And if it isn't a major component, we wouldn't see the situation to begin with, so there has to be some sort of explanation.
Just like some people are naturally short and immune to limbo bars, some bacteria naturally have a pre-existing resistance to antibiotics. Not because they've gained this ability after an encounter with the antibiotic, but it's just always been the case.
That's just always been the case. Of course, before the invention of antibiotics, bacteria can still be resistant, because in nature we find them all over the place. Fungi and even bacteria themselves, for example, produce antibiotics. In fact, our antibiotics are usually based off some sort of source from nature. The first one, penicillin, was from a fungi. Anyway, before we have ever used antibiotics, they already existed, so bacteria have always already evolved against them. So it's no surprise that you would see random resistance here and there before humans took advantage of these drugs. But if we're talking about resistance to an antibiotic that has never been seen before, that really wouldn't happen, but it also depends on how you define resistance. For example, some of our antibiotics target very specific things, so as a result they only affect certain strains of bacteria, but not others. These are called narrow-spectrum antibiotics. An example is sarecycline, which only affects gram-positive bacteria, which are bacteria that generally have thicker cell walls. Antibiotics that target these specific types of bacteria usually do so by breaking down their cell wall components that gram-negative bacteria do not possess. Things like, say, the thick peptidoglycan layer. As a result, these narrow-spectrum antibiotics will only affect some bacteria. So then, in this example, would you say that these gram-negative bacteria are resistant? Not really, but technically they are, because they don't possess the drug target. Now expand this a bit and think of bacteria that existed before the modern use of antibiotics. Sure, you could find some bacteria that are resistant, but to what extent can you call them resistant? For example, an antibiotic that targets a specific enzyme, but some bacteria have a different type of that enzyme and are thus resistant. That's technically one of the four ways I mentioned in which antibiotic resistance can occur, but it's also natural that they're like that. In other words, it's not black and white that these resistant traits, quote, already existed. There's lots of nuance that blends the idea of resistance.
That said, bacteria do have a neat special ability that short people don't have. They love to share. Not just cooking recipes and financial advice, but super personal things like their very own DNA. They'll swap loops of DNA called plasmids in a process called horizontal gene transfer, or HGT. Like third graders with Pokemon cards, they have no idea how they got them or even what they do, but they'll trade them back and forth, and occasionally, they'll share these resistance genes. Nothing new has been made or evolved, though. Bacteria already had the ability to trade plasmids, and the genes for resistance already existed before antibiotics.
Horizontal gene transfer is a nightmare when it comes to combating antibiotic resistance, because it's essentially creating a resistant population without needing to create a new generation, which is significantly faster. But yeah, that doesn't take away the point of the argument at all, since it simply serves to accelerate the process. Plus, sharing around genes is technically a type of evolution, it's just not natural selection.
This is hardly an arms race, and it's not a demonstration of Darwinian creative power, since there's no new mutations and no new genes that have been made.
That's incorrect. Even if we give you the argument that these resistant genes already existed, that still doesn't stop the fact that mutations occur, and that can be the primary mechanism in which new resistant genes is formed and becomes common in the population, because that most certainly still happens. Plus, if you don't want to believe this, then fine. It's easier to see in viruses. They don't really have proofreading enzymes like we do to try and fix mutations, so they mutate at a much faster rate and can develop new strains incredibly quickly. I mean, we already see this with the pandemic going on right now. And of course, you can accelerate this process just by introducing some evolutionary pressure. Monoclonal antibodies. So yeah, look into viruses. They don't share DNA like bacteria do, but rather across species. Very interesting, I must say.
Not only that, but these extra resistance genes are frequently a net negative on fitness. Bacteria with extra useless genes tend to be less fit than regular old vanilla bugs. Imagine you're in a foot race. You usually don't need a duffel bag filled with camping supplies, a pickaxe, spare bowling balls, and a weed whacker during your typical foot race. If you do, great. Otherwise, it's a huge waste of energy lugging all of that stuff around, and it makes you less competitive. bacteria with extra genetic load tend to be less fit than regular old vanilla bugs.
That's true. Resistance sometimes comes with a cost, so if that pressure is relieved, usually the non-resistant bugs would thrive better. But of course, that's not always the case and would depend on exactly what mechanism was used to produce resistance. However, I do think it's a good general rule to follow.
Now, what about mutations, though?
This is the second less common, but more interesting way that bacteria develop resistance to antibiotics. How does it work? It's sort of like someone who has no arms saying that they're immune to handcuffs. No legs? You're immune to toenail fungus. No teeth? Congratulations, you're immune to cavities. Think of how much you'll save on toothpaste and floss expenses. Deaf and blind? You're immune to getting annoying songs stuck in your head. Wow. This poor soul might technically be immune to those things in a perverse way, but it comes at a cost. He's hardly a more fit organism, and these mutated bacteria are just hobbled, busted up versions of the original.
Wow, that is some hot bullshit. Where did you even get the idea? I get it, you want to say that mutations only take things away, not add anything, but like we've shown numerous times already, that's completely incorrect. Sure, loss of function mutations are more common, but that doesn't mean gain of function mutations don't exist, because they very well do. Plus, one mechanism I listed that can cause resistance, changing or modifying the drug target, is hardly anything more than just simple mutation that changes the drug structure, without significantly altering its function or active site. But anyway, creationists need to stop saying that mutations only take away things. It's a false idea that stems from nowhere really, and saying it just demonstrates your inability to understand what mutations in evolution really are. So for the love of Poseidon, please stop. Alright, so for the next part he starts talking about an evolutionary experiment, which we won't get to today. I would like to give an extended shout out to some more patrons. Thank you to Fireshard, Alan Morton, JN, Ms. Fixit, Dennis Pake, Rick Klen, Chris Britton, Dave Osler, Tom Schaffer, Garrett R., and Michael Dean for their generous support. I will see you all later.